Cammile Adams, room number four, the 22-year-old from Cypress, Texas, coming to the wall. And it will be Cammile Adams getting the win in the women's 200-meter butterfly final.
Welcome to Houston Sports Talk with your host, Robert Land.
Thanks for listening to the best Houston sports podcast. And hey, as somebody who will try to watch every second of every Olympic Games, I can't tell you how thrilled I am to be joined by a two-time Olympian in the 200 butterfly, who also happens to be a native Houstonian and a Texas A&M alum. I'm talking about former Cy Woods Wildcat Cammile Adams. And I can't thank you enough for doing this in this crazy time, Cammile.
Oh, thank you so much for having me, Robert. I'm so excited to join you guys.
I understand, even though your dad swam in college at Lamar and was an instructor, you said you weren't exactly a natural swimmer as a kid, right?
Yeah, a little bit. So my dad is actually a coach and has been a coach my entire life. So he started coaching when he was like 18 or 19 years old and is still coaching, which is just how my sister, I have a twin sister. So it's how we got into the sport. And other Olympians, national team members, high levels, swimmers in general have tried a lot of other sports. For me, just because my dad already had the background in it, and for my sister as well, we never really wanted to try anything else. And so swimming is just kind of like what stuck, and it was just in our blood. So I think definitely like growing up being younger, you know, wasn't always the best swimmer. But obviously really enjoyed it. For me, it was so much about the community of it and the friendships and things like that. So I think that's what got me so interested and wanted to, you know, eventually make a career out of it, is just like the lifelong friends and relationships that I've made through the sport.
Do you feel like sometimes when you're at the Olympics, you're like, well, I just was that person that didn't quit doing this and just kept putting in the effort? Because I know when I was a kid, I was in gymnastics here in Houston when I was about 7 years old. And I stopped at about, 9 or 10 years. I did it for about 2 or 3 years and I was doing statewide stuff, but it just wasn't a big enough thing for me. But one of the guys that I started off with when I was 7 years old, he ends up in the 1996 Olympics. So it's possible that you're not exactly the biggest person or the strongest person that comes out of it, but it's just the person that just doesn't quit.
Yeah, I think so. I think a little bit of that is, I really do enjoy doing difficult things and challenging things. That's just part of my personality, especially being on the distance swimming side of things, but then also like the butterfly side of things. I feel like butterfly is probably the hardest stroke to train and that sort of thing. And so I just always really enjoyed that. And then it was fun for me to like set goals as a kid and continuing to strive to be better in the water, better out of the water and all those types of things. And so for me, swimming gave me so many opportunities to just grow as a person. And I think that's really what made me the person I am today, is so many of those lessons that I learned about like dedication and, you can go a little crazy staring at a black line for so many hours a day, but you become really mentally tough. And so I think some of those types of things have transitioned really well into what I call like regular life, real life. Post-swimming and post-retirement and all that type of thing. But I definitely think, the grind, I guess, of it after so many years, you either get better or you don't. And for me, luckily, it worked out.
And you just finished fifth at the 100-meter fly at the state high school meet when you were at Cy Woods. Is that right?
Yeah, I think, oh my gosh, I'd have to go back and look. I know I won state in the 100 or maybe in the 500 free. I won state my senior year. But yeah, so definitely I only swam for the high school my freshman year and my senior year, which is kind of how my training schedule worked and my travel schedule worked. I was traveling a lot with the USA Swimming junior national team. So, I was trying to factor it in those trips and training schedules for those as well. So it just happened to work out that I only swam those 2 years, but that was also such a fun experience for me. And swimming in high school was definitely more of a team atmosphere and, a lot less pressure and just more fun, if anything else, which was a cool way for me to be involved within within the school program.
So what is it like to be in the Olympic trials? Because I remember you did it. It seemed like nothing was bothering you if you're looking on. And what were you feeling before that race? And at age 20, to know that you've got this one shot in 4 years to make the Olympic team.
Yeah. So I actually went to my first Olympic trials in 2008. So I was like 16 years old and, ended up placing 17th. So didn't even get a second swim. And I really went more for experience and to just like learn the meet and be there and just kind of take in the surroundings and that sort of thing. And it's such a big meet, so much bigger than any of the other nationals or anything like that. And so it was just such a good opportunity for me to go and learn. And I was obviously super bummed that I didn't get a second swim, but, you know, only being 16 years old, I think it was such a good learning experience for me. Fast forwarding 4 years later, then going into being like the number one, number two, 200 butterflyer in the country at the time, and really just trying to recall some of those things that I had learned when I was 16 about that meet specifically, and, you know, watching other people and watching their careers and watching, you know, what the veterans were doing and that sort of thing, and just watching the top of the top swimmers and just really learning from them. And so I think it only helped me going into the 2012 games and just helped me be confident about, you know, what to expect and what the nerves would be like and all those, you know, what the stands and the fans and, you know, it's just such a bigger stage. And so for me, I think it only really helped me. So then in 2012, obviously being like the top first or second, I was super nervous, but knew, you know, I had a decent shot at making the team and was really just excited to race. I remember that's probably one of the most excited as far as like energy wise. I wasn't super, super nervous. Like I was in London. That's the most nervous I've probably ever or ever will be in my entire life. But at the trials, I just thought it was so fun. And, you know, it was so exciting for me to represent Texas A&M and have my entire teammates there supporting me. And there was quite a few Aggies that made it. And so it was just a really fun experience to do that with my team there. And so, yeah, so two, obviously, between 2008 and 2012, two completely different experiences, but also extremely fun. And it was cool how they kind of intertwined together.
Well, Adams kind of with that tilted head breath can see to her left. She can't see to the right now, but you know that she can kind of feel that wall and she's going to win it.
Is there any way to explain to non-Olympians and non-twins that moment when you mentioned your sister, Ashley, your twin, and you start screaming her name as soon as the race is over with? What's it like that moment when you're screaming her name and she's coming you know, coming up to you and all excited?
Yeah, I think I tell people all the time, like being a twin is probably one of the greatest gifts that God could have given me. It's such a cool bond that we have and we still have. And she actually was swimming at Texas A&M at the time as well. And so it was just, I think for her, she kind of knew that maybe the Olympics was never in the cards for her, but she was so on board with me and cheering for me and probably wanted it more for me than almost I wanted for myself, if that even makes sense. And so, like I said, it was just a really cool experience. And then also for my dad as well, just, you know, having the swim background that he does. And then my mom is like the best swim mom you could ever have and ever imagine to have. And so with our little family and stuff, it was just a really, really cool experience for all four of us, I think. And I think each of us kind of handled it a little differently. I think my mom was probably the most nervous. My dad was probably the most confident. And then my sister and I were just excited. We were just like, we're just, you know, here to have a good time and hopefully make the team. and so we all kind of had our own little spins on it in 2012.
Yeah, that's fantastic. And hey, I just met you and this is crazy, but tell me anything about the Call Me Maybe video. I mean, if I need something to put me in a good mood, I pull it up on YouTube and the video just always puts a happy face on me, you know?
I know. Yeah, I totally know. I still can't listen to that song. We listened to it so many times. No, I just think that, you know, that month or so, 4.5 weeks between trials and the Olympics is just such an intense time. And everybody is so intense and very methodical and very, you know, they have their training plans very thought out and everything has a purpose. And so I think, you know, things like that, like the Call Me Maybe video, you know, was just really a chance for everybody to just kind of like let their hair down and just realize that, you know, we're all just humans, and just gave everybody a chance to get to know each other. You know, for some, there was a lot of rookies on that team. And so it was nice for everybody just to put some of the serious stuff aside, you know, outside of practice and just really just meet each other and get to know each other.
I threw a wish in the well. Don't ask me, I'll never tell. I look to you as it fell.
so it was a super fun experience, I think, for everybody to kind of do that and have that all together. But like I said, I still can't listen to the song. Just too many times.
I heard it was a little bit hard to get some of the boys into it. Is that right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I think, but you know, I think the ones that did, you know, they were all on board, as I'm sure you could tell in the video.
Yeah, they were having blasts. What was it like to be a part of that 2012 team? Because my sense, you know, when you're watching the Olympics, I guess over all the years, because I've been watching since 1980, that this was maybe the best team, best USA swim team ever. 49 medals altogether. The names are just ubiquitous for everybody that follows swimming. Phelps, Lochte, Ledecky, Missy Franklin, Dana Vollmer, Nathan Adrian, Natalie Coughlin, and on and on. You know, what was it like to be a part of that whole team?
Yeah. So a little bit about like my history and leading up to that point is similar to like other Olympians play other sports. Most other national teamers and Olympians, when they go and they make their first Olympic team, they've made a world championships or a Pan Ams or a Pan Pacs or other national meets before just the Olympic Games. And I had not. So in January of 2012, I dropped about like three and a half seconds. That put me from like 7th or 8th in the country to 1st or 2nd. And so having not ever made another team, you know, I remember in 2008, you know, like watching Michael Phelps on TV and being like, that's so cool. And watching Ryan and that and all that kind of Natalie Coughlin and all that stuff. And just, you know, really being Caitlin Sandineau, you know, all those people and being like, wow, this is so cool. And so to all of a sudden look around and be in the room with them and be putting on the same cap as them and, you know, in team meetings and practices with some of my heroes was one of the coolest experiences. And so for me, you know, I was kind of like really trying to take it in, trying to do a lot of watching on what other people were doing and just really learning. I definitely just had complete wide eyes the entire time and just trying to take in as much as I could and learn as fast as I could in 2012. And so for me, by the time I got to the games, obviously completely different all around to then experience them, the trials. The trials is actually, I think most people would say, way more nerve-wracking, way more anxiety than the Olympic Games, because the Olympic Games is kind of just the cherry on top. You've made it. Now you just want to like have fun and do the absolute best you can. And so I was really fortunate enough to have Kathleen Hersey as kind of like a mentor. And so she was the other junior butterflyer and she swam at Texas at the time. And she really took me under her wing and, you know, was like, this is what it's going to feel like. It's going to be the most nervous you've ever been in your entire life. You know, this is the fans are going to be louder than you've ever experienced, you know, all those types of things. And she was just by my side the entire time. So, you know, I can't thank her enough. She is literally, she kind of saved me during that experience because it obviously was super overwhelming having never experienced that type of meet before. But it was really, I was in such a cool position, I think, to be able just to be a sponge around so many of our country's like greatest swimmers of all time. So I think it was just a really fun and obviously humbling experience for me.
As cool it is to compete in the Olympics, it's maybe just as cool to walk in the opening ceremonies. Were you able to walk in the ceremonies in London or Rio?
No, I didn't. I didn't actually walk in either because swimming, sorry, it's the first 8 days of the games. And so most people don't know, but for opening and closing ceremonies, it's about an 8 hour long ordeal. So obviously when you're getting ready for the biggest race of your life, you're not going to go and want to stand for 8 hours. So most swimmers have never walked in opening ceremonies unless they swim like the last day or two of the meet. So they have like almost a full week to recover or over a full week to recover. I did stay in London for like two and a half weeks and ended up walking in closing ceremonies. I stayed with like Allison Schmidt and Shannon Vreeland and Haley Anderson, and my sister actually stayed. And so there was a group of like 6 or 7 girls and we all just got a little flat in London and just wanted to sightsee and tour around. And then we ended up all staying and walking in the closing ceremonies, which was really, really fun.
What is that like? What do you remember about that whole experience of the closing ceremony?
Yeah, well, Spice Girls was there, so I'm pretty sure you can't beat that. no, it was really, really fun. You know, for me, it was so, you know, I could continue to get to know like the girls and get to travel a little bit and just have fun with friends. I think for, you know, obviously leading up to that point, everything had, like I said before, had just been really intense. And so at that point, you know, it was just fun to hang out together and not have to train, obviously, or you know, worry or have all that nervous energy and stuff built up. So it was just fun. And then it was so cool to have my sister stay and get to hang out with the other girls and stuff like that.
What do you remember about that 200 fly finals in London?
It was probably the most nervous I'll ever be in my entire life. I remember like my legs could not sit still in the ready room. Like I was sitting in a chair and I remember my legs are just like bouncing off the floor. And I just remember just being so excited. You know, Kathleen, I think Hersey was maybe not equally as nervous and she kind of had knew what to expect a little bit more, and or at least knew how to manage nerves better than I did at that point. But, you know, she was like, Camille, I just really think that we just need to go out there and like have fun. So she bought us these like American flag, like high knee socks just to remember and remind ourselves and us specifically like who we represented and who we were doing this for. And so that was just a really a kind of a cool thing. So we both wore them out to the blocks together, which it looked absolutely ridiculous, but you know, it like made me laugh and made me just, be really, really grateful for the opportunity. And so, yeah, again, so just going back to Kathleen and how thankful I am for her.
So even after the trials, you still get super nervous at the finals. The trials doesn't help at all to get you kind of warmed up like the, and I mean, even the prelims, I should say as well.
Yeah, I think it did. You know, it's just completely different when you know it's an Olympic final, just completely different.
So in the 2016 games in Rio, you had a wild few weeks. You just gotten married. There's a crazy scare where you almost get disqualified in the trials, then barely make the Olympic finals. And you're in the eighth lane. It just, everything goes nuts, but you end up making this surge to finish fourth. And I guess I should start by asking, is there anything more annoying than finishing fourth at the Olympics?
Yeah. So I think, there was a few things that led me right into retirement. Obviously the DQ at trials being one of them. So for those that don't know my story, I was DQ'd in the prelims at trials and I'm kind of like a one hit wonder. 200 butterfly is my baby race. And that was really the only chance I had at making the team. And, so luckily the call was overturned as similar to like football where you can kind of review a play. You can review the official's call at that level of our sport.
Talk about a roller coaster of emotions. This, just a moment ago, Cammile Adams realizing that she is not disqualified. And so as they took a closer look at it, Rowdy, they agreed with you, no infraction off the wall for Cammile.
They were able to pull the underwater video and reverse the call. The longest 8 minutes of my entire life right there. Ended up going on and making the team, which was great. I was actually elected as a team captain. So completely different experience altogether from 4 years earlier. So that was probably one of the biggest honors that I'll ever receive. And it was such a cool experience because my two best friends from the Olympic team, Allison Schmidt and then Elizabeth Beisel, were also captains as well. So the three of us got to do it together. And it was just such a fun, you know, thing to do, the three of us all together. And then I had like a decent prelim race at in Rio. And then my semis race like wasn't that awesome. It just didn't pull it all together. You know, you don't always have reasons why races don't go as planned and they don't go like you've trained them for. And I don't really, you know, have an answer for that all the time. And I just think that for me personally, I just had to, you know, suck it up and go into the final and do the absolute best I can and stick to my race strategy as much as I possibly could. You know, I was used to being in the middle of the pool for the most part. And then now being in an outside lane is obviously not really where you want to be. So, you know, I had done lots of mental prep work and just really building my confidence up and just really retraining myself to really believe that I belonged in that final and that sort of thing. And then I went to go get on the blocks in the Olympic final and my goggles actually broke.
Oh my goodness.
Which is never very much fun. So, ended up like I wear two caps. And so I took off my top cap and like tied my goggles on the side and then put my top cap back on and, actually had like the slowest first 50 that, I probably had in a very long time. Which I think was good. I think it meant that at that point I knew how to handle my nerves and I knew how to handle when situations don't always go your way. And I had trained for that. I had trained mentally for that. And so, you know, growing up, your coaches always say like, if your goggles break, you know, just step off the blocks. The starter will wait on you. They will not start the race without you. And that's just what I kept telling myself. And it's what I've been told since I was 8 years old. And, you know, that's exactly, you know, what I did. I just stepped back and tied my goggles up and put them back on and went for it. And then, I mean, obviously getting fourth totally sucked. I won't even lie to you. Not getting a medal what isn't fun, you know, but I definitely was super proud of myself and going a best time in Olympic final. I was super happy with how my time ended up and how I split it. And then just the journey in general was crazy to get there. And so I think through those few things, retirement just made the most sense, made the most sense for me and where I was at. And I was really ready. I actually got married right after Rio. So I got married in October and then the games ended in like August. So, I came home and wanted to, you know, obviously we were getting married and, I was just really ready to kind of do something different, just ready for that next stage of life, if you will.
Yeah. I mean, I'm thinking when you're done with the race, you don't always know where you finished. Did you look up and immediately see fourth, or did you know when you touched the wall?
I didn't know exactly where I finished, but I was pretty sure I was like third, fourth, or fifth. I think we were all like pretty decently close. So I had like a good idea, but wasn't absolutely certain. There's on the blocks, there's lights. And so there's a one dot light if you win, and then two dots if you're second, three dots if you're third. So I looked at the block and I knew there were no lights. So I knew I didn't medal. And then that's when I looked up and saw fourth.
Can being in the eighth lane help you at all in that finals, or is it just bad?
Oh, I think for me personally, it wasn't ideal. I'll say that. But I've also like always believed that if you have a lane, then you have a shot. And Michael actually like pulled me aside and he was like, Cam, I mean, like you've trained for this, you know, you always train in the outside of the pool. You're always in the distance group, you know, and, you know, you can do this, like, this isn't out of your, you know, and he told me a story of, you know, through it when in his career, when he like won a medal in lane eight or whatever. And I think it just was really cool for me to just, you know, see that. Truly, like all of Team USA, we really do root for each other and want the absolute best for each other, both in the pool and out of the pool. And so I just really appreciated like that sentiment and that time that he took just to pour into me. And so for me, I'm a side breather in my butterfly. So I breathe to the left and most butterflies breathe forward. It's just with my stroke, it just worked better for me. And so on the first and the third 50, I actually didn't see anybody, which is not ideal. But again, it just allowed me to swim my own race and stay in my own head. And yeah.
So like the rest of the country, I fell in love with Missy Franklin in 2012. And you've been on two Olympic teams with her. What story comes to mind when you think of her, either in the pool or just personally?
Oh my gosh. I was actually texting with her yesterday. She's just such a light, I think. And when you really get to know her as a person, I think you kind of see all the sides of her and she really does want like the best for people. And she is the best cheerleader that you could ever want on your team and to have in your corner. And, you know, I think there's like so many of those people through the Olympics that I've made that, especially during this time right now, during while we're all quarantined, I've really been deliberate in trying to like reconnect with some of those people that I don't always get to talk to just because life gets in the way. And so just trying to reach back out and, you know, just catch up and those kinds of things. So it's obviously this is not the situation that we're in right now is not ideal, but, I think we've all tried to make the most of it and just try to like stay in contact with each other, Missy included.
You guys, it's just been sort of the same journey with the two of you because you both competed in 12 and 16. It was your first Olympics together. And so I imagine just, you know, you feel like your career and her career sort of coincide a lot in a lot of ways.
Yeah, I think so. I think so.
Also, Katie Ledecky wins the gold at just 15 years old in London. She grabs four more gold in Rio. You're a witness to all of that. What was it like to sort of witness her unreal rise and just incredible stardom as a young swimmer?
Oh my gosh. I remember being in the stands in London and watching her. And the only thing I could think about is this girl can't even drive yet. She can't even legally drive. But it was so much fun to just get to watch Katie and even over the years, even now, just getting to like follow her journey and cheer her on. And, I think she also just has such a good head on her shoulders. She really is such a good role model. She's so smart and just very well poised and put together and makes really good decisions. And one of the hardest trainers, if not the hardest trainer that I've ever watched in the pool. And so I think it obviously shows through in her races. And I think she really enjoys the sport and truly has fun doing it. I think that also definitely yields to why she's been one of the greatest swimmers we've ever seen. So yeah, I definitely remember watching her. I know Ryan Lochte's 400 IM in London was the first time I got to sing the national anthem with everybody, and there was not a dry eye in our little Team USA section. I remember just like that feeling. I'll never forget it. It was one of the coolest experiences for me personally, just getting to watch and cheer the whole team on. I think it was so much fun.
Did you get much interaction with Michael Phelps over the 2012 Olympics, or just at all over your Olympic experience?
Yeah, I'm really good friends with Allison Schmidt. I would go out and train with her a couple times between the 12 and 16 games. So I think I went out to visit them like three different times. So I got to train with him some and like Sierra Runge and Allison and their whole little group. Bob Bowman was so nice and allowed me to go out there and just switch up my training a little bit and get some Arizona sun, which was fun as well. You know, just get to train with him and Chase Kalish. And, you know, there was such a good group of people and trainers out there. I also got to train and do some like private stuff with Missy Hyman, who is my absolute biggest hero in the sport. And she's kind of the first person I remember watching on TV in 2000. And when she won gold in the 200 fly, I just remember being like, that is so cool. Like, I want to do that someday. So getting the opportunity to also learn from her and kind of shadow her and train with her between the two games is also one of the coolest experiences I'll ever have, I think.
Yeah, I was going to ask you who did inspire you. I got a couple of rapid fire questions for you. What's your favorite keepsake from the Olympics?
Oh my gosh. Probably the flags that everybody signs. So when you make a team, they put all these flags out on all these tables and every athlete gets one. And then you get a second one to like send to a coach. And so I have like everyone's signatures from both Olympic games. So those are probably my favorite.
Funniest member of Team USA.
Oh my gosh. Right. Ryan Lochte for sure. He's like, I tell everyone, he's like my little brother that I never asked for and honestly never wanted, but somehow got. And he's also older than me. we just kind of have that relationship. We trained together my last, I guess, like almost two and a half years on and off. And especially my last 18 months, we trained a lot together, like just me and Rye. And so got to know each other. He's definitely like one of my favorite people that I've ever got to know in life. So I would say he's probably my funniest for me.
Which athlete outside of the swimmers were you most excited to meet?
Probably the basketball players, like the dream team and stuff. I think that they came into the village pretty much in 2012, pretty much just to meet Michael or see Michael. But we all got to like sit there and watch and like take pictures. So I think that for me personally, I think that was pretty cool.
What's your favorite all-time non-Cammile Olympic moment? I mean, a moment that maybe you were watching on TV as a kid or that you got to see outside of swimming in 2012 or 2016?
Yeah, I think definitely Ryan's like the 400 IM when he won and getting to sing the anthem for the first time. That's really the memory that like rings in my head. And then I also think Katie Miley was my roommate in Charlotte when my last like 18 months. So just watching her medal and get on the stands in the 100 breaststroke was also just one of the coolest things. You know, we had trained side by side, even shared an apartment together. We lived, eaten, breathed, did everything together for the last like year and a half or so of our careers. And so just watching all her efforts pay off and all her hard work pay off was just such a cool experience too.
Best song and favorite musician or band to get you psyched up for a swim or a workout?
Oh my gosh. Also crazy. I listen to country music and that's pretty much it. So I do like lots of country music before races. You know, I think it was always different. I don't remember exactly what I listened to, but it's always been country music, which is kind of odd, I guess.
Well, not for Texas girl. A Texas girl. That sounds just about right. Well, how about the low-key worst part about the Olympic experience?
Oh my goodness. Probably just the like, you just have to adapt, I think. It's, you know, some days like the bus wouldn't show up, so you would have to walk and get on another bus, or, you know, the bus would show up at a different spot, or, you know, whatever, like the food you wanted wasn't in the dining hall. And so really just learning to just adapt, I think. You know, some days the pool would be empty for warm-up, and other days every single athlete would be in the pool. And so you just really have to go with the flow. My coach at A&M would always say, don't let the highs be too high or your lows be too low. And that's probably one of the biggest pieces of advice that I've taken now into my career, even like right now, while we're sitting in quarantine, that has rung so much in my head and just me continuously reminding myself, don't get too overly excited about things, but then also, you know, don't let yourself, you know, get too down about things. And so I think definitely during the Olympic experience, like when there was no bus and you had to walk to the pool, you're just like, okay, this is what's going to happen. I'll just get a couple more extra minutes of music listening. You know, just things like that, I think, or, you know, my semis race wasn't where it was, you know, I just had to, you know, buckle back up and continue to look forward. And so, yeah, so I think that's probably one of the biggest things.
Most annoying part of swimming, chlorine hair or pruney skin?
Oh my gosh. Oh, chlorine for sure. I have super sensitive skin, so the chlorine and I always battled it out.
I want to bring it a little bit back to Houston because in 2016, of course, Simone Manuel, another Houstonian, pretty much shocks the world with that 100 meter free gold medal. Is there any kind of special connection you have with her, with the Houston bond?
Yeah. I mean, we grew up swimming pretty much together. She's, I think, 4 years younger than me or 3 years younger than me, but, I grew up like knowing Simone and knowing her coaches and that sort of stuff. So our journey pretty much coincided as well. And so it was really cool to watch her kind of have that breakout swim and just continue to get better at Stanford and with Greg over there. And I'm excited for her in 2020. I think she's going to absolutely kill it. I can't wait.
Were you there for that race? Did you see her reaction when she won?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, definitely. I, even before my 200 butterfly, I watched pretty much like all the swimming from the stands. For me personally, like that just got me excited and like kept me into the meet. And so, yeah, I definitely watched, and it was fun, you know, to see her family and, you know, her club coaches from when she was 8 years old and, you know, getting to watch them on Facebook and stuff like that, I think was also just a really cool experience just to, you know, how many people that we both had at home cheering for us really made, I think, the moments so much more special.
Tell me a little bit about Save Splash before we go.
Yeah. So in 2016, when I retired, I taught in the public school system here in Houston for 2 years. So I taught 1 year in Cyfair, and then I taught my second year in HISD. I just miss being around the pool, and I just wanted a little bit more of like a challenge and just to do something different than teaching. And I just didn't really feel, I always thought I was going to be a teacher my whole life. My dad was in education, and so I just thought that that's where I was going to be. And then when that didn't really fulfill me, like I thought it was going to, you know, I was like, okay, well, you know, what am I going to do? What's next? And so, the swim school, so it's a part of a franchise, and I had reached out to them learning a little bit about what they did, and they actually had 6 locations in Houston for sale. And so, yeah, I purchased those in May of 2018. So it's almost been 2 years. Which is crazy. And so now I tell people all the time, I seriously have my dream job at 28 years old. It's teaching and swimming merged into one. We teach like, you know, kids all the way up through adults. My adult lessons are some of my favorite lessons to teach. And so it's just really fun. All my schools are in gyms. So we call them like hosted locations. So we rent the space, which has been absolutely amazing way to buy the business and learn. And that way I'm not, you know, responsible for all the pool maintenance and all those types of things on the financial side, but we are opening up my own pool probably in like January of 2021. And so, I'm super excited about that. And I'll be doing like lots of my own like private lessons there for higher level swimmers and club kids and that sort of thing, which I'm so stoked about. Cause I really do love continuing to get back to a sport that truly changed my life. And so I think it's important for me, and it's also how I'm fed, is just continuing to give back. And so, so I'm excited for that. And, I'm mainly employ like high school and college age kids. And so I think I'm just, have become a really good role model for them to just do some soul searching, do some digging, find out what you love in life and what you're really passionate about. And nobody has to work a job that's just 9 to 5 and they just get a paycheck and they come home and they do it again the next day. You can find something that you love and that you enjoy and that fills you. Cause I found it. And so, yeah, so it's been fun.
Well, thank you for all the great moments that you gave us and your teams gave us over the last couple Olympics. And just thanks for doing this. Really appreciate you coming on.
Of course. Oh, thank you so much for having me. It was wonderful.
And look at Adams pulling ahead of Bear after that final turn.
You're listening to Houston Sports Talk.
Don't forget to follow Houston Sports Talk on Facebook and Twitter. Subscribe to us on iTunes, Spotify, the Google Podcast app, or the Stitcher app. You can support us by giving us a 5-star review on iTunes or by telling your friends about us. Spread the word, everybody. Thanks for listening.